I'm Jeff Yarger. I'm a professor of chemistry, biochemistry, and physics.
And I'm Vladimir Mujica, but I'm a professor of chemistry.
So, Vladdy, we've been using YellowDig this semester in teaching a physical chemistry course. And what I like to do in YellowDig, which is more or less a social, you know, media platform or a way that they can communicate. And I like the strategy of giving them, you know, simple problems to solve as a way to, you know, really promote dialogue. And I tend to, because the field we're working in physical chemistry is very mathematical, I tend to ask both some basic math questions, because I never think, I always want to remind them that brushing up on the language of science is never a bad idea. And I do it myself. You know, I brush up on areas in Lie algebra or areas in, you know, infinitesimals and stuff like that all the time to get better skill sets for using mathematics in what we do in science. And so I ask not only questions directly related to the topic we're covering, for example, thermodynamics and biological systems, but also just some basic math.
Yeah, and just as a side comment on that, we were just discussing this morning that some of the most important giant steps in science happened in the past when the mathematical structure of physical theory was revealed.
Yeah.
And then people could move amazingly fast.
Quantum mechanics,
electrodynamics, gravitation.
Yeah.
Thermodynamics.
Yeah. Think of Gibbs himself, you know, right? Like, so I think it's very important. Now, we also touched on in another video that, you know, it's often a very practical thing is when you ask a problem, oftentimes, you know, the problem itself can be dissected in how well the problem has really been articulated. And so I want to give you something here. And this is why not only do I encourage students to, you know, circle a yes or a no here, but give a comment to why, give an explanation. Because I often find that it's these explanations that actually can provide more insight than just thinking you understand it by, oh yes, oh no, et cetera, right? And so I want to give you one right now. The amount of, you know, no versus yes is, you know, about, you know,
50-50.
They've answered kind of both to this question. And, it, you know, originally if you, it's a very simply asked question. And so what I want to do is get your opinion of whether you think that this question is worded well enough that it can be answered definitively yes or no, or whether you think that the actual question has enough ambiguity that if you give a justification for either answer, that either could be right. And let me start by saying, you know, what is the typical justification for somebody who says yes? Is that the implication here is that that they wrote A to the B is equal to 8/2, so that they're giving the exact structure of that. So what they're implying is that A is equal to 8 and B is equal to 2, and therefore A times B is equal to 16. And that must be that way because of this formulation right here. Now, what most people who say no recognize is A to the B is a general way of just writing a mathematical that those are two independent variables from each other. And they wouldn't make this assumption. They're just saying that this is equal to 8/2, which basically just means it's equal to 64. And so we can eliminate, in a sense, and this makes it a much more clear statement. If you just say A over B is equal to 64, well, now you can think of several A and B variables that all would give this. You can think of, you know, well, the famous one is this is just a binary of 2^3, so that'll be 2^6, right? And 2 × 6 is equal to 12. Which is, means that must, you know, this wouldn't be the case, right? Or obviously 64/1, 4/3, et cetera. In other words, there would be a range of solutions here, and that's why they claim it's no.
Right. So, and I think that the key word here, and you have it in
In bold.
Bold. Of course, you can add there must necessarily be equal to, but let's say must equal 16. Then I would say that the question is appropriate. I mean, you can give an answer to this, and you can explore some other alternative. I mean, you can even take B log A equal to 2 log 8. And then I will get a very different solution.
Yes.
Because if I transform this exponential equation into a logarithmic equation, I can certainly realize that I don't know whether the answer to this is an infinite number of solutions, but probably not. But
right.
there might be some constraints. But I see here that the number of solutions is not one or two, because I can adjust this even numerically. Of course, it wouldn't be. Now, if you ask the questions in the sense that find an integer solution to this, then the number of solutions will be
finite.
Finite.
Yeah, yeah. But if you don't even, B in mathematics never, you would have to tell a mathematician that those are only the real numbers are only
now,
right.
This would be a constraint. This would be a constraint if you are going to ask for a
right.
real number. And an even more complicated constraint would be if you ask this to be complex numbers.
Yes, exactly.
In which case, this is going to be really, really messy. So I would say that in the way the question is worded, the answer would be no. But again, I mean, this question, the fact that it is not even specified whether A and B are integers or real or complex numbers, it give a lot of ambiguity to this. So,
well, and the point that people, and I would agree with you. I mean, in fact, I did this question assuming most people would do no, and everyone, there would be maybe only a few yes. I mean, and it was gotten off brilliant.org who, the answer was meant to be no. But I like that at least people who wrote yes, when they wrote that this is kind of their justification, and even when I explained it, their justification saying, well, writing it in this way was kind of a trick. They considered it a trick question because they're writing it in the same form as this, almost implying that A, they're implying that A is equal to 8 and B is equal to 2 by writing it in the same form
right.
of that. But, what I would give as a comment back to that is, but again, the explicit, the explicit way math people use variables like that is that they are independent variables. And that is an assumption that you would just have to know about how math problems
right.
are written. Right.
Right. No, I was just going to mention that there is a very famous, it's a very tricky thing, but you start with A equal to B, and then you take B squared, and then you subtract minus A squared equal to B squared minus A squared. And then this is A times B minus A. And this is B plus A times B minus A. You remove these two. And then you have
A
equal to B plus A. And then A equal to 2A. Oops. So 1 equal to 2, 2 equal to 4, etc.
Exactly.
Of course, now you have to be extra careful here because certainly the trick is that this step is forbidden because you are dividing by 0 because B minus A is equal to 0. But this tells you that whenever you are playing with this, with equations, you have to be aware of the domain of definition. You have to be aware which numbers you are bringing into play
right.
here.
Well, and to me, just that anytime, I mean, to me, it's the whole basis of algebra, right? Is that we use symbols, or variables to represent, a whole range of possibilities. I mean, so to me, the whole reason you put A and B is to realize that those are you know, those can have a range, and you would have to limit them to say, like you said earlier, the real plane or just this, or we're going to limit ourselves to just the real numbers or just this and that.
Right. Just to mention a very famous one, if you try to solve this equation, then you realize that particular equation doesn't have a real solution, doesn't have an interior solution.
Yeah. And like you said, pretty famous. You know.
It's very famous because the solution of this is that the x is equal.
But learning this, you know, learning, you know, things about the complex plane and its relation to, you know, repeating functions or, you know, oscillatory functions and, you know, exponentials and, you know, Euler's equation. And I mean, I think this gets about at a heart of something you and I say a lot, which is I'm not asking simple math questions as something as a complete aside. Math is the language we use in all of science.
Yeah.
And so to hone your skills on even some of the simple math stuff, I think is always worthwhile because you should be as comfortable with it as possible if you're really going to work in science at all.
Absolutely. And it's not math as our enemy, as many students think, as a hurdle, as an obstacle. It's actually, we can't even talk about science in some cases without math.
You can't talk about a lot of things. A lot of people forget how much of the basics of logic are based in mathematics and other, I mean, like, it really is pervasive, you know. I think, you know, who was it who said, like, it's the, how, you know, what surprised him most is how unreasonably well math works in describing everything, you know. It was Penrose or someone recently. Anyway, I think we get away from the initial topic, but I appreciate you spending some time on this, and I hope students appreciate it as well,
no,
and some of the polling questions we're going to ask through the semester. Thank you.